ఐటీసీ కాకతీయాలు మంత్రి కేటీఆర్ మాట్లాడుతున్నారు. లైవ్ ద్వారా చూద్దాం.
In the landscape, as far as we can see in India. So information technology and the technology prowess of Hyderabad. You know, we have some of the largest companies in the world whose largest bases are here. Amazon's world's largest base is in Hyderabad. Largest campus is in Hyderabad, not in Seattle. Google, Apple, Meta, Microsoft, of course, and, you know, Salesforce, Uber, Micron, Qualcomm, all of these companies, their second largest bases in the world outside of their headquarters is right here. In fact, we have more than 1 million people working directly in technology from Hyderabad. Now, what does this do? On the one hand, we have strong presence in life sciences, where we have more than 450,000 people working in the life sciences area. And we have technology, where we have more than 1 million people working right here in Hyderabad. We all know how pervasive technology is in today's world, because technology has literally not left any sphere of life untouched. We live in a world, you know, where devices talk to each other. We live in a world of interconnected devices. The day is not very far for those of us who are over 40 and over, you know, into the middle age. Let me tell you, the day is not far when your phone is going to give a command to your car, which will in turn talk to your refrigerator, which will also in turn talk to your doctor, you know, daughter or son, which will also in turn talk to your, you know, stereo, and make sure that everything is synchronized and you move in a seamless fashion. The day is not far. Might sound a bit far-fetched, it might sound a bit like a science fiction movie, but the day is not far. Why am I bringing that up? Technology has become so pervasive that even pharmaceutical industry, even life sciences industry, is not exempt from the pervasiveness of technology. So we have Novartis in Hyderabad, who employs 9,000 plus people, who's actually only doing, out of which only 400-500 people are doing pure play research and development in a laboratory. The remaining people that are working for Novartis are engaged in digital drug discovery, are working as biostatisticians, are engaged in biomedical engineering, are engaged in biomedical innovation. Technology, therefore, is going to be that beautiful point of confluence for other spheres of life. If you could be a manufacturer. We have Schneider here in Hyderabad, whose factory has been rated as one of the best lighthouses in the world in terms of smart manufacturing facilities for their factories across the world. And now Schneider is a global company, but their factory here has been rated as one among the best in the world in terms of leveraging technology and bringing in practices with respect to Industry 4.0. So that is the sort of pervasiveness of technology I'm trying to bring up to your notice. I keep saying this and I can't say it enough. Hyderabad is that place where biology meets technology, where life sciences meets data sciences, where mangoverse meets metaverse, where paratha meets dosa, where idli meets dokla. The reason why I say this is because India needs economic engines like Hyderabad to continue to attract talent from across the country and across the world. We cannot make do with what we have alone. Of course, we want our youngsters to get lion's share of the jobs, but we also need to understand and emphasize that we need talent no matter where it is from. See, some of our youngsters from Telangana and Andhra are living in the US, are living elsewhere in the world. If they want to come back and set up shop here, they want to come back and give their learnings and give their knowledge, impart their knowledge and create enterprises here, would we not welcome them? So exactly, you have talented individuals across the country in India today who we would want to attract. In fact, the point of confluence, technology plus other spheres of life, as I was pointing out, has become so pervasive that today, if you look at the world order, the largest book seller in the world does not own a bookstore. The largest transporter in the world does not own a single vehicle. And the list goes on. Uber, Amazon, neither of them actually have any physical assets in terms of the business they actually are engaged in. So what we need to understand is how paradigms are being redefined, how new business opportunities are emerging. So therefore, Telangana government, understanding this fully and wanting to leverage sustainable mobility, the electric vehicle revolution that's unfolding, we have now launched the Telangana Mobility Valley. Because we understand that automobile of the past was all about design, was all about how robust it should be, how reliable it should be, etc. But the automobile of today, the electric vehicle that we all have taken a fancy to, is nothing but a computer on wheels. It's largely technology and electronics in the machine, and very little hardware, if you ask me. So therefore, this Telangana Mobility Valley that we have launched in four different clusters around Hyderabad, manufacturing in Zahirabad, I'm thankful to Mahindra and Mahindra, who have recently announced a 1,000 crore investment. I'm thankful that they would be manufacturing electric autos, the three-wheelers from there. It's one of their largest growing segments. Likewise, I'm also thankful to Amar Raja Batteries, who's now setting up one of their largest investments, 10,000 crores almost, in Divitipalli, in Mehboob Nagar. And I'm also thankful to several other operators who've signed on to create this vibrant mobility valley. What Genome Valley has done to the life sciences industry, I'm pretty confident that the mobility valley will do to the sustainable mobility industry, and Hyderabad will become the nucleus in India of this specific industry, which has an immense potential in the decades to come, in the years to come. I'm very confident, and those of you who are looking at, in fact, I met several entrepreneurs now, or battery makers, charging infrastructure makers, etc., etc., and even lithium ion, you know, cell manufacturers, etc. I look forward to working with you, look forward to engaging with you, and bringing more and more investment to Hyderabad. Now, another important sector that has done rather well in Hyderabad is aerospace and defense. We're very proud of the accomplishments of the aerospace and defense industry in Hyderabad. Look forward to consolidating more and more on that, because this is again a very exciting time to be a defense or aerospace player, because lots of new things are happening, lots of exciting things are happening, lots of joint ventures are happening. The world cannot do without Indian talent, without a question, because India is getting younger and younger, the world is getting older. Our median age is 27. 65% of India is less than the age of 35. So the Indian talent, which has now received a resounding endorsement from across the world, is something that we want to latch on to. We want to continue to build knowledge economy. And as part of that, in fact, aerospace and defense industry is something that I'm looking forward to with a great deal of optimism. But of course, going back to what Mr. Jacob said, he asked me the very first time we met, he said, do you want investment or employment? What is your focus? Of course, I said, I need employment, because as I said, we have a lot of youngsters. Every year, we have hundreds of thousands of graduates coming out of our education system. Now, government can only gainfully employ so many directly. What is the task at hand? What is the biggest challenge every government across the world has? It is the task of people management. It is the task of how do you manage this human capital, the so-called demographic dividend that is there for us, you know, that is up for grabs. So every government across the world, not just India, needs to start assessing and looking at the kind of human resources we have at our disposal and create more and more opportunities. So when Mr. Jacob told me that KTX is the second largest kids apparel manufacturer in the world, of course I didn't want to let him go. I said, I'll send you a flight, please come. And then he actually came in, and he not only chose to invest 3,000 crores, more importantly, he's creating 28,000 jobs for Telangana. I think he deserves a huge round of applause. I'm very hopeful that with taking his lead, taking his inspiration, more and more garment manufacturers come our way. Because there are some things which are hidden, some facets of Telangana which have not been explored yet. Recently, I met a gentleman called Senthil, who's from Southern India Mills Association. He was telling me that the quality of cotton produced in Telangana, the long staple cotton that is produced in Telangana, is the best in India. He said, your cotton quality is far superior to what we use in Tamil Nadu, what we use in Gujarat, and what we use elsewhere in the country. Now, this is something that has not been explored. But all he said was, you need to purify it, you need to brand it, you need to market it, so that more and more garment manufacturers, more and more textile manufacturers come here. Now, this is a huge employment generating opportunity. We've already launched Kakatiya Mega Textile Park, where KTX is the anchor. It is India's largest textile park in about 1250 acres. Not only do we have Kitex, we already have a unit running by Ganesha Ecosphere. We also have Young One, a Korean company, who's also taken 300 acres of land, who's also going to start, you know, construction very, very soon. Now, this park alone will create hundreds of thousands of jobs. Similarly, we have ambitions to create smaller clusters of opportunity in garmenting and textiles. More importantly, electronics, another very, very exciting area. You may have seen the announcement recently, last week, in fact. We had unveiled India's largest prototyping facility called as T-Works, because we want to encourage product innovation coming out of Hyderabad, product innovation coming out of Telangana. The chairman of Foxconn was here. He had unveiled T-Works. He had a great meeting with our chief minister. He has again, because there was some confusion with respect to what was said and what was agreed upon, so he issued a rejoinder yesterday, a renewed commitment yesterday, saying, I'm committed to investing in Telangana, and we have chosen Kongar Kalan, the 200 plus acres of land in Kongar Kalan, to set up our manufacturing facility. I'm very, very hopeful that with Foxconn and other electronic manufacturers coming in, not only will the local ecosystem get a huge boost, but it will create great many opportunities for Telangana youngsters going forward as well. But I can't close out without talking about what is happening in the rural area in Telangana as well. Under the leadership of our Honorable Chief Minister, we have completed, in a span of 36 to 40 months, we have completed the world's largest lift irrigation project called as Kaleshwaram. Those of you who have a doubt, you can Google it. You can just type world's largest lift irrigation project. You would see Kaleshwaram. We're literally lifting water from about 82 meters above sea level, pumping it all the way through a multi-stage lift irrigation project, multi-stage lifting system, to 618 meters near Hyderabad at Konda Pochamma Sagar in Gajuel. Now from there, of course, Hyderabad is at 535 meters. This project not only provides irrigation potential to 45 lakh acres of land, it also provides drinking water to Hyderabad and also most of the districts en route. And most importantly, it also gives you potential to industrialize. 10% of the water is also earmarked for industrial consumption. Why am I bringing this up? Because when water is in abundance, through Mission Kakatiya to the various projects that we have completed, five new revolutions are unfolding in Telangana as we speak. Now, what are these five revolutions? The first one, of course, is the green revolution. Telangana today is competing with the likes of Punjab and Haryana in terms of our paddy production, in terms of our ability to come out with world-class food products and agriculture products. I'm thankful to ITC, who set up a large unit in Tupran with more than 1,000 crores of investment. But I'm looking forward to working more and more with you, the rest of you, in who are interested in setting up agri or agri-based industries, food or food-related industries in Telangana. Because we have a problem of plenty now with respect to water, agriculture produce, and what we can do with it. We, of course, are self-sufficient. We would want to ensure that most of this is exported, and we want to continue to unfold these revolutions and latch on to these revolutions. The first is a green revolution. The second one I'll talk about is a blue revolution. Telangana today, because, you know, before the formation of the state, when somebody used to talk about aqua, we used to think about Godavari districts, Bhimavaram and thereabouts. But today, Telangana is the number one state in India for inland fisheries. Because of all the rejuvenation that has happened in the lakes and tanks, 46,000 lakes and tanks in Telangana through Mission Kakatiya, and because of all the new reservoirs that have been built as part of Kaleshwaram, as part of other irrigation projects, we have become the number one state today in India for inland fisheries. Now, what does this do? Today, my district, Sirsila, Rajanna Sirsila, has become a hub for aqua-based industries. Now, we have companies such as Fishin, CP Foods, which is a Thai-based company, Fishin is an American company, who are wanting to come there and set up cage culture and culture tilapia fish, export 100% to the United States. Now, these are opportunities, again, which I also want you to kindly explore, because we have fantastic fiscal incentives, we have the ability to customize packages for you. Please explore these as well. The third revolution that's unfolding in Telangana, besides the green and blue, is pink revolution. Pink revolution is not that of my political party, but of course that also is true. pink revolution is the meat processing industry that's flourishing in Telangana because of the improvement in the number of livestock, because of a program that we have taken called as a sheep rearing. You know, our chief minister says something very interesting. Whenever we talk about skill development, whenever we go tell him, sir, you know, we have this brilliant new initiative of skill development, he asks, you know, skill development is good, but what about the already acquired skill that we have in our population? We have people who can rear sheep, we have people who can weave beautiful fabrics, we have people who can do magic, you know, because that is what they've learned over the years. What about them, the brilliant craftsmen that we have? So what has happened in Telangana because of the sheep rearing program is our livestock has doubled. Again, we are now one of the largest meat producers in the country. And this gives us opportunity also to create meat processing potential, not just for Telangana, Andhra, but also for the rest of the country and also possibly for international markets. The fourth revolution that's unfolding also is white revolution, dairy revolution. In Telangana, you know, when we started our journey 8.5 years ago, our state-owned dairy, Vijaya Dairy, was in losses. But today, Vijaya Dairy has turned around. It is actually giving a dividend back to the state. Not only Vijaya Dairy, we also have Karimnagar Dairy. We have Mother Dairy in Nalgonda and Rangareddy. All of them are thriving. And therefore, you see a white revolution unfolding. And please don't underestimate the white revolution. I know of a company called New Zealand Milk Products, NZMP, from my working days back 23 years ago. There's one company which was earlier called Fonterra, or probably now called Fonterra. One company alone in New Zealand contributes to 8% of GDP of New Zealand as a country. So the opportunity to do more in dairy and dairy processing is something that you cannot undermine, you cannot underestimate. I would urge you to look at this opportunity as well. And the last one, the last revolution, the fifth revolution, that's also unfolding in Telangana. India is hugely reliant on imports for edible oils, and we want to change that. We have set ourselves an ambitious target of 20 lakh acres under cultivation for palm oil. Oil palm revolution is typically called the yellow revolution. Now, this yellow revolution is also unfolding in Telangana. We are offering tailor-made incentives to those farmers who are wanting to get into this field. We are also offering incentives to those who want to come forward and set up oil palm factories in Telangana. So with these five revolutions, green, blue, pink, white, and yellow, Telangana's rural hinterland is also going to see an explosion of industrialization. And I urge all of you, promising entrepreneurs, settled entrepreneurs and enterprises in this room, industrialists in this room, to start looking at opportunities in the hinterland as well. Of course, life sciences is exciting, technology is exciting, electronics, textiles, garments is exciting, aerospace is equally exciting, logistics, education, there's a number of other fields which are exciting. But I think these five revolutions together between them have the potential to create opportunities for millions and millions of youngsters. And to harness all these five rural revolutions, like I just mentioned, Telangana is also creating special food processing zones, like how we have ITSEZs in Hyderabad. We are creating special food processing zones with customized incentives. So those of you who are interested, I remember a day when I was a kid in school, when Hyderabad was the nutraceuticals capital of the country. I remember ki hame ek bar excursion pe le gaye the. Bus mein baith ke hum log gaye the, shayad kaatedan tha ya kuch aur tha, ya uppal tha, yaad nahi hai. Ampro biscuit factory gaye the hum log. Pata nahi Ampro hai ki nahi, aaj yaad bhi nahi hai. Jaate hi wahan pe pura khushbu, wo biscuit wala khushbu aane laga. Achha laga. Aaj kahin wo khushbu nahi milti hai. So my point is, we had our strength, we had our presence in nutraceuticals in a big way. We need to find it again. We need to start latching on to those opportunities as well. The last thing I'll say, of course, it's easy to criticize, it's easy to say a lot of things. India as a country needs to prosper, needs to grow. But if it needs to grow, then union government also needs to start looking at performing states, looking at states that are doing well, encouraging them, because ultimately India is a union of states. India, as defined by the Constitution, by the way, this is not my definition, is a union of states. And a federal republic, unless we play to our strengths, unless we empower our states, unless we incentivize performing states and also encourage non-performing states, we would be doing a great disservice to the ambition that we have for ourselves. You know, it's all good to give beautiful slogans. Make in India is a good slogan. But has it translated into reality? I had a meeting with the All India Medical Devices Association as part of the BioAsia program. The gentleman who heads AIMED, his name is Dr. Rajiv Nath. He told me, sir, we had 1,200 units in the past. Now 600 have shut down. We only have 600. We need to ask ourselves some hard questions. We need to introspect. We need to start asking questions such as, why is it easy for us to manufacture in China, import it thousands of kilometers, still sell them cheaper than our manufacturing, than locally manufactured goods? We need to have commonsensical answers to that. What about our duty structures? What about the availability of raw material? What about our illogical, conditions that we, not conditions, but in fact roadblocks that we put in the way of our entrepreneurs prospering and competing with the rest of the world? My humble request through this forum to all the industry here, to the people who have the ears and, who have the ability to get an audience with Prime Minister and others, please tell them that there are states that are doing well, and if only the rest of India can possibly also do equally well, we would have already been a 5 trillion economy. If the rest of India actually did as well as Telangana did, I'll back it up with numbers. When we started our journey in 2014, our per capita was 1,24,000 rupees. Today, our per capita is 3,17,000 rupees. Our gross state domestic product back in 2014 was 5,06,000 crores. Today, it is 13,27,000 crores. On both these counts, we have risen. We have enhanced by 155 and 162%. The rest of India, unfortunately, did not do as well as we did. If only the rest of India did as well, we certainly would have reached the ambition of 5 trillion target in 2022 itself. Unfortunately, even though we are a performing state, we are penalized. Hyderabad Pharma City, which will be the world's largest pharma cluster, will not receive support from the government of India. Kakatiya Mega Textile Park, which is the largest park in India for textiles, has zero support from government of India. We will not receive new manufacturing clusters for electronics. We do not receive, we were promised in the Act, Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act, that industrial corridors would be promoted. Special incentives would be given for industrialization in the state of Telangana and Andhra. I speak for both states. Unfortunately, they have not materialized in 9 years. We need to ask these questions. We need to say, what was promised as part of the legislature, as part of an enactment, as part of a statute? If that is not honored, then where is the sanctity of calling ourselves the world's largest democracy? If we, in the abode of democracy, in the temple of democracy, the promises made are not kept, what is the sanctity of this institution then? I'm asking a very serious question. My humble request to Government of India is, we may not be affiliated with you politically. That's the beauty of democracy. Not everybody is going to like you. I'm sure there are a lot of people in this room who don't like me. Fine, so be it. But the point is, beauty of democracy is divergence of opinion, divergence of our country, diversity of our country, the heterogeneity of this brilliant country. Aap kon hote ho decide karne wale ki kisko kya pehenna chahiye, kisko kya khana chahiye, kisko kya bolna chahiye? Ye kahan ki reet hai? All I'm saying is, if you understand that India is a union of states, and if stronger the state, stronger the country, then encourage and pat us, incentivize performing states moving forward. Only then we'll see India as a first world country. Thank you very much. Jai Telangana, Jai Hind. Working directly in technology from Hyderabad. Now, what does this do? On the one hand, we have strong and the technology prowess of Hyderabad. We have some of the largest companies in the world whose largest bases are here. Amazon's world's largest base is in Hyderabad. Largest campus is in Hyderabad, not in Seattle. Google, Apple, Meta, Microsoft, of course, and Salesforce, Uber, Micron, Qualcomm, all of these companies, their second largest bases in the world outside of their headquarters is right here. In fact, we have more than 1 million people working directly in technology from Hyderabad. Now, what does this do? On the one hand, we have strong and the technology prowess of Hyderabad. You know, we have some of the largest companies in the world whose largest bases are here. Amazon's world's largest base is in Hyderabad. Largest campus is in Hyderabad, not in Seattle. Google, Apple, Meta, Microsoft, of course, and, Salesforce, Uber, Micron, Qualcomm, all of these companies, their second largest bases in the world outside of their headquarters is right here. In fact, we have more than 1 million people working directly.